Good morning again. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
Kevin, good morning. Larry, good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning to each one of you out there. We've been talking about the three angels' messages. We've talked about the first angel's message some. We've talked about the second angel's message some. Today we're going to begin talking about the third angel's message. I'd like to invite you to open your Bibles to Revelation chapter 14. And we'll be reading verses 9 through 12. And the third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice, If any man worship the beast and his image, and receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture into the cup of his indignation, and he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb. Verse 11. And the smoke of their torment ascendeth up forever and ever, and they have no rest, day nor night, who worship the beast and his image, and whosoever receiveth the mark of his name. Here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. The United States Marine Corps has a slogan, and it says, We're looking for a few good men. They said if everybody could get in the Marines, it wouldn't be the Marines. They're looking for a few good men. Not just anyone can be a United States Marine. It's pretty hard. The basic training is twice as long as the Army. It's more difficult than the other services. It places greater demands upon the Marines. The Marines are almost always the first to go to battle. But God, I want to tell you today, God is looking for good men and women. Not that we are good of ourselves. Our goodness only comes from God. We have nothing within ourselves to trust. But he's looking for men and women, young and old, and all those in between, who will recognize the call that he's giving to people today to go into, as it were, spiritual battle, into a great battle, the greatest conflict that this earth will have ever seen, and be prepared to stand for God. The Apostle Paul, I believe, was such a type of man as this. He was dedicated to Christ, and he was willing to endure great privation for Jesus. If we would turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 11, we can read a little bit of what Paul says that he experienced. And this is just mostly on the physical side of things. But in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, beginning in verse 24, he says, Of the Jews, five times received I 40 stripes, save one. Thrice I was beaten with rods, once I was stoned. Thrice I suffered shipwreck, a night and a day I have been in the deep. And then in verse 26, in journeyings often, in perils of waters, in perils of robbers, in perils by my own countrymen, in perils by the heathen, in perils in the city, in perils in the wilderness, in perils in the sea, in perils among false brethren. And then he continues this little section by saying, In weariness and painfulness, in watchings often, in hunger and thirst, in fastings often, in cold and nakedness, beside those things that are without, that which cometh upon me daily, the care of all the churches. And you think you've had trials and tribulations, a little phone not working or something not just being quite right. The Apostle Paul, he was willing to lay it all on the line for God, wasn't he? Amen. I mean, this man, he just knew no limit of what he was willing to do for Christ. Why do you think that Paul was willing to endure such hardship? Why was he willing to go back into Lystra, for example, where he had been stoned to continue to preach there? Why was he willing to continue to preach in Philippi after he'd been beaten and imprisoned there? Why was Paul willing to continue, apparently in the minority, in the face of assault? And I think the answer is relatively simple. It's in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 14. And there the Apostle Paul says simply, The love of Christ constraineth us. It is the love of Christ that constrains us. The love of Christ that controls us. It is the love of Christ that is the very spring of action in our lives. The love of Christ was so deeply ingrained in the heart of the Apostle Paul that no sacrifice was for him too great. And beloved, when the love of Christ truly constrains us, there will be no sacrifice that will be too great for us. God is going to have a group, a special group of men and women here at the close of this earth's history, people who will be living just before the close of probation, who will love Jesus so much. And I like this statement from the book Education, page 57, that they will love Christ so much that they will stand for the right though the heavens fall. It doesn't matter what's going to come upon us, what will befall us, what will be in front of us or behind us. God's going to have a group of people that are going to lay it all on the line for Him. God will have a group of men and women who will continue in the face of the assault of the enemy, and they're going to proclaim the three angels' messages. The first, second, third, and I assure you they will continue with the fourth angel's message of Revelation 18 as well. And it's because there is a remnant of believers who keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus that Satan exhibits such wrath. In Revelation chapter 12 and verse 17, you know, the Bible says that he has great wrath against those who keep the commandments of God and the testimony of Jesus. And as we continue our study on the three angels' messages, and as we begin to look especially at the third angel, we're going to understand why Satan hates this message so much, because it points out the truth of God's character, and it reveals the malignity of his character as well. And it's going to reveal to us, this message, what God is going to be able to do to and through and with a man that Satan has all along has said has been impossible. And it's going to reveal Satan to be the liar and the deceiver that he has been all the way through. And I want to tell you, friends, this is a serious message. It's the most serious, the most solemn warning ever given to mankind in all the Bible. And the serious nature of this message, it must not, it cannot be overlooked. The third angel's message, friends, is one of life and death. And I'm not just talking about temporal life and temporal death. We're talking about eternal life, whether we're going to be eternally saved or whether we're going to be eternally lost. Because those who receive the mark of the beast, they will be eternally lost. And why those who receive the seal of God will live with God and Christ forever and ever. You know, as Adventists, we have rehearsed the Mark of the Beast crisis, the Sunday Sabbath issue, many times. And a little bit later, hopefully, we're going to be going over those things as we continue the study on the third angel's message. But that's not where I want to focus today as we begin. Instead, today, I want to focus our goal on what the third angel's message really points us toward. And that's a word that's almost become a dirty word in theological vernacular of Adventism today, but it is the word, very simply, we call perfection. Perfection of character is what the third angel's message is really pointing us toward. You know, when attention is given to a serious issue, God just doesn't say it once. He says it repeatedly, and he emphasizes it usually over and over. He tells us, for instance, in Isaiah 58 and verse 1. He says, "Cry aloud, spare not. Lift up thy voice like a trumpet and shew my people their transgression and the house of Jacob their sins." He says, "Cry aloud with a loud voice." And how is the third angel's message given? With a loud voice. Friends, God doesn't ask that the message be given in a corner or with a timid voice. And I want to tell you, this message that God wants us to give, He wants us to give it clear and all the way through. We're told to cry aloud with this message of sin and salvation. The message of the first and the third angels specifically say that they are given with a loud voice. And we've been told by the Spirit of Prophecy exactly what this means. In Manuscript Release, Volume 14, on page 159, she says this message, and she's referring, quoting here, Revelation chapter 14, verses 9 through 12 that we read earlier. This message embraces the two preceding messages. It is represented as being given with a loud voice, that is, with the power of the Holy Spirit. And so, beloved, as we witness, as we share, as we receive, we need to pray for the power of the Holy Spirit so that the message can be given in its proper tone and attitude. Furthermore, in the Bible, when we are told to give a message, we are told to give the whole message. In Deuteronomy chapter 4 and verse 2, if you turn with me to Deuteronomy chapter 4 and verse 2, we read there what we have the counsel from God to Moses. He says, "You shall not add unto the word which I command you, neither shall you diminish aught from it, that ye may keep the commandments of the Lord your God, which I command you." So we're not to diminish or take away from it. You know, people like to do that, don't they? It's easy to give the part that's popular. It's easy to give the part that people enjoy hearing. And there are parts of our message that may even seem hard to give to some people, but we easily give it to our own community because we know our own community accepts and receives it just quite well, and they want to hear the good old Advent movement message. But we're a little slow and we're hesitant to share it with the people who really need it. But we're not to diminish. And those who fail to give this message will find the truth of Romans chapter 1 and verse 18. Romans chapter 1, verse 18. There the Apostle Paul says, "For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness." One translation says, I think the New King James, for example, says, "who hold back the truth in unrighteousness." In other words, we have the truth. We know what it is. But we hold it. We don't share. We don't give it to those who are in desperate need of it. Isaiah 58 verse 1 also tells the people of God that their voice is to be trumpet-like, sounding loudly, clearly, resonating deeply into the hearts of the hearers. I might ask a question. Why do these messages have to be given so loudly, so clearly? What is the reason for the seriousness of the nature of this? Because, friends, again, those who reject the messages will at last receive the mark of the beast, and they will be lost forever. Let's just read back those couple verses in Revelation 14, chapter 10 and 11. He says, "The same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture into the cup of his indignation, and he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb." In verse 11, "And the smoke of their torment ascendeth up forever and ever, and they have no rest day or night, who worship the beast and his image, and whosoever receiveth the mark of his name." Find me any two verses in the Bible that speak as strongly and as assuredly of damnation, of wrath, than these. You know, in all the places that you read about God's judgments in prior history, they've all been mingled with mercy. But here we find something that is going to be poured out upon people that is going to be poured out without any mercy, without any, it says it's poured out without mixture in verse 10 there. That means it's not diluted any. Now this corresponds in part to the Ezekiel's vision that deals with the slaughter of the wicked that you find in Ezekiel chapter 9. If we could turn to Ezekiel chapter 9 and we'll read verses 4 through 6. Ezekiel 9, verses 4 through 6. And the Lord is speaking to a destroying angel. An angel that's going to mark and destroy. And he says, "Go through the midst of the city, through the midst of Jerusalem, and set a mark upon the foreheads of the men that sigh and that cry for all the abominations that be done in the midst thereof." And in verse 5, he says, "And to the others he said in mine hearing, Go ye after him through the city and smite. Let not your eye spare, neither have ye pity." Verse 6, "Slay utterly old and young, both maids and little children and women, but come not near any man upon whom is the mark, and begin at my sanctuary." Then they began at the ancient men which were before the house. And I want to tell you, when they got done, they came back and they said to the Lord, "We have done as thou hast commanded." We might think, you know, it says begin at my sanctuary. Judgment begins at the sanctuary, begins with the ancient men. And we might say, you know, they've led this people into apostasy. They've led them down to the wrong road. They deserve it. Let them have it. But that's not where it stops. It says, "Men, maidens, and little children, that they all also perish together. All those who stay in this corporate situation, and I'm not afraid to say this corporate situation. You know, you could say, well, you know, the church I go to, they don't celebrate. They don't do yada yada, and we have a good preacher, and he tries to preach the truth. But friends, only those who sigh and cry for the abominations done in the midst of the church, the cities of the church, are going to receive the seal of God. Just sitting back and being timid and quiet is not going to make it. You will not receive the seal of God. You will be cut down in the slaughter of the wicked. Though the slaughter begins again with the ancient men or the leaders, it doesn't stop there. God says that he will not spare, nor his eye have pity. And he says this in Ezekiel 5:11, 7:4, and 9, chapter 8, 18, and chapter 9, verses 5 and 10. In Ezekiel, God says it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 times. Do you think God means what he says? And he says what he means too, friends. Don't think that we can escape this. It's not going to happen unless we are fully in Christ and we have followed the first, second, and third angels' messages. You see, friends, God must be God. He doesn't change. There's no variableness in him, neither shadow of turning. He must work consistently with his character of love, but also his character of justice. And he is never capricious. He doesn't act based upon feelings, though his heart is full of feelings. He rather acts out of principle. He acts out of principle. To allow his wrath to be poured out without mercy, as it says in Revelation chapter 14, God must exhaust all of his power to warn the wicked. He desires all the wicked to turn from their ways so that they may live. In Ezekiel chapter 33, in verse 11, Ezekiel 33, verse 11, he says, "Say unto them, as I live, saith the Lord God, I have no pleasure in the death of the wicked, but that the wicked turn from his way and live. Turn ye from your evil ways, for why will ye die, O house of Israel?" Yesterday, some group set off some kind of an explosion in a mosque in Egypt. You probably heard. And there were maybe about 235 people that were killed, not from the explosion, but as people were fleeing from the mosque, there were people outside waiting with guns, automatic weapons, and they began to just shoot people indiscriminately. And there were over 200 people killed, over 100 people shot and injured besides the dead that I know of as of yesterday, and it's probably went up. We live in a wicked world. The Apostle Paul says, "Know this, that in the last days," what? "Perilous times shall come, dangerous times, times when you can just lose your life at any moment." And that's what we're living in today. And we may face danger, and we will face danger. But like the Apostle Paul, friends, we can be sure of God's help. In 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 7, 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 7, the Apostle Paul says, "For God hath not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and a sound mind." One translation says, "God has not given us a spirit of timidity as Christians." We've been told in Testimonies, Volume 8, on page 42, "This is the scene that is presented to me, but the church must and will fight against seen and unseen foes. Satan's agencies in human form are on the ground. Men have confederate to oppose the Lord of hosts. These confederacies will continue until Christ shall leave his place of intercession before the mercy seat and shall put on the garments of vengeance." And then she continues, "Satanic agencies are in every city, busily organizing into parties those opposed to the law of God. Professed saints and avowed unbelievers take their stand with these parties. This is no time for the people of God to be weaklings. We cannot afford to be off our guard for one moment." Do you think that applies today? Does it have any application for us today? I believe it absolutely does. Absolutely does. You see, friends, God is all wise. We say he is omniscient. Some people theorize, they say, well, God lives in the presence, but for God, everything is the presence. The past, the present, the future, God lives through it all. He somehow sees and knows and experiences all at once. I don't know about that. I don't understand the theology of that. I won't claim to know it. But I know this, that God knows everything that's going to happen. And in his foreknowledge, God knew of this last day crisis on this earth and what would be involved, and he's now preparing the people for that crisis. And there's a special group of people that are specifically mentioned in two places in the book of Revelation, and each time they are shown as God's answer to last day apostasy. And I'm speaking about the 144,000. In Revelation chapter 6, verses 12 through 17, you have the description of the sixth seal and the coming of Christ, and at the time when all the wicked attempt to hide themselves. And they say, for the great day of his wrath is coming, who shall be able to stand? And you know, you turn into chapter 7 and you get the answer, the 144,000. Remember that the chapter and the verse divisions that we have in our English Bibles today were not in the original text. The original text just has text running all the way through, with the exception of maybe the Psalms and a few other places. You just basically have the beginning to the end written out, and we've subdivided those sections into chapters and verses to make it easy to locate and what we think sort of groups thought ideas together. But in Revelation chapter 6, you have a continuous flow into Revelation chapter 7, verses 1 through 8, and there you find a description of the 144,000. The second time the 144,000 are mentioned is in Revelation chapter 14, verses 1 through 5, and that's in response to the crisis of the mark of the beast and the image of the beast of Revelation 13, the very mark of the beast that we're commanded in the third angel's message to avoid. In Sermons and Talks, Book 1, pages 72 and 73, we have this. She says, let me read, and then she quotes Revelation 14, 1 through 3. And she says, why were they, referring to the 144,000, so specially singled out? Because they had to stand with a wonderful truth right before the whole world and receive their opposition. And while receiving this opposition, they were to remember that they were sons and daughters of God, that they must have Christ formed within them, the hope of glory. They were ever keeping in view the great and blessed hope that is before them. This group of people, friends, she says, and I'll just go back to it here again, they're going to stand with a wonderful truth. What kind of a truth?
Wonderful.
We don't need to get rid of it, do we? We don't need to sell for a mess of pottage, do we? We don't need a new paradigm of thought, do we? We already have a wonderful truth, friends. Because they had to stand with a wonderful truth right before the whole world and receive their opposition. May I remind you, in Revelation chapter 4 and verse 5, it says that the 144,000 are without fault before the throne of God, and they have no guile in their mouths. They have no deceit. They teach the truth. They are without fault. These are people who have bridled their tongues. As James says, if any man offend not in word, the same as a perfect man, and the tongue can no man tame. If no man can tame the tongue, then 144,000 have learned to totally depend upon God so that he has now controlled their lives as well as their tongues. And this is the alone thing that can give them the power that they need through his Holy Spirit to clothe them with the righteousness of Christ. It's no wonder that Ellen White, speaking of this message, of the third angel, says this, several have written to me inquiring if the message of justification by faith is the third angel's message, and I've answered, it is the third angel's message in verity. In truth, it is the third angel's message. A.T. Jones understood this quite well. He began to speak and speak and speak and would not quit speaking about this. And people heard him speaking so much and reading so many of his articles and the bulletins from the Review, and they wrote Ellen White. They said, is this really the third angel's message? As Elder Jones is saying, she says it's the third angel's message in verity. To see the larger issues, friends, we sometimes have to go below the surface, sometimes we have to step back, but involved with the seal of God and the mark of the beast is whether we will worship the Creator or the creature. That's really what it comes down to. It comes down to a matter of worship, whether we're going to worship the Creator and his way and keep his law, or we're going to worship the creation of man. We're going to either do things God's way or man's way. And the fact is, the Bible says that the number of the beast is the number of man. Now, in Revelation 13, 18, In the King James Bible, it says, "Let him that hath understanding count the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man, and his number is 666. But there's a couple points I'd like to make to you. In the Greek language, the article is sometimes very difficult to correctly ascertain when it should and shouldn't be there as we translate it into other languages. But it says here that that this number is the number of a man, but you need to understand that in the Greek language, there's no indefinite article. There's no a, there's no an. The text just says it is the number of man. Also, according to the grammar, the pronoun that we translate his, it's altu, and it can be translated as his, or it can be translated as a neuter, it. Because number, by the way, in Greek is a neuter word. It's not masculine or feminine. And so the pronoun also can go, of course, his goes back to man, but his number, it fits together better actually to translate it like this. This is my translation. "Let him that hath understanding count the number of the beast, for it is the number of man, and its number is 666. I think I also have the Lexham English Bible's translation of this. "Here's wisdom, the one who has understanding, let him calculate the number of the beast, for it is man's number, and his number is 666. Now, why there are interpretations of 666 that we've looked at in the past, I'm sure, and I'm not trying to throw any veil upon any of those. You know, we've talked about vicarious filia Dei before. But in looking at this in its broader picture, we know that the number six is the number that falls short of perfection. It's the number of man. And this whole system of worship of the beast and the image of the beast is the worship of man and what man says. And it falls short of the perfection of God. Now, the basic principle that underlies every false religion in the world is the claim that man has the ability to raise himself by himself in some way. In other words, you pick yourself up by your own bootstraps, and it's a salvation by works. And the Bible teaches us that salvation is by grace through faith alone. The Bible presents man as having no ability to do anything to elevate himself. Man needs a Savior. He is totally dependent upon and in need of Jesus to save him from his sins. And this is why Ellen White made this statement, and I think it's so beautifully written. She asked the question, what is justification by faith? It is the work of God in laying the glory of man in the dust and doing for man that which it is not in his power to do for himself. When men see their own nothingness, they are prepared to be clothed with the righteousness of Christ. And that's what we need, friends. And so this whole issue of the third angel's message, it ultimately comes down to worship. It comes down to whether we're going to worship God and worship God according to his ways and accept God's salvation, which means that we are saved by his grace through faith alone. We are saved by his grace to walk in newness of life, or whether we're going to be saved by the requirements of man and doing our own thing. And we know that the issue, and we're going to look at it in detail later, but we know that the issue, outward issue, is going to come down to whether we're going to keep the seventh day Sabbath or whether we're going to keep Sunday. Isn't that right? We know that. We'll look at the details of it later. We'll prove it from the Bible later. But that's what it comes down to. The Sabbath is a sign of righteousness by faith through the merits of Christ. Sunday is a sign of righteousness by works through keeping the commandments of men. One or the other. We can't have both. Justification by faith is the work of God in doing what man is not able to do for himself. And the issue of the mark of the beast comes down to doing things our way, which is the way of failure, versus the way of God, the way of truth and perfection. It comes down to worshiping man instead of the worship of God. And we have to make a decision who we're going to worship. And if we worship God, then the third angel's message, friends, will take us on to perfection. And it's my appeal to you today to set aside the things of man, to set aside the commandments of men, the traditions of men that Jesus spoke about. And he said, for in vain do they worship me, teaching for doctrines the commandments of men. But friends, the worship of the true God. And the book of Revelation, all the way through, the one central theme of the book of Revelation is worship. Worship, worship, worship. Who are you going to worship and why? And if we're going to be living saints here at the end time, if we're going to be that a part of that group that Sister Arlene was all the time mentioning about, pray that I can be a part of the 144,000. If we're going to be a part of that group that responds to the beast and the mark of the beast issues, then we're going to have this same conviction that Paul had, that we are going to serve God no matter what, because his love constrains us. And the only way, friends, that we really ultimately know that love of God in the most emphatic way that's going to save us through that time is to know that Jesus is really the Son of God. And you know why I say it, don't you? Because in 1 John chapter 4 and verse 8, it says God is love. And here it says in verse 9, it says the love of God manifests that God gave his only begotten Son for us. And this is how we know God loves us. This is the measure of his love, that he gave his Son. So, you know, people ask me sometimes, they say, well, why do you make such an issue about who the truth about God is speaking about? Because after all, the great crisis is going to be over the Sunday Sabbath issue, isn't it? And I say, yes, it is. But remember, that's simply the test that reveals something else. It's going to be the test that reveals who we worship and why. And whether we have the spiritual fortitude put in us by the love of God to stand for him during that time. And that's what I want. And I pray it's what you want too. So may God bless us, friends, to take his word, to believe what he means, to know that he says what he means, and to be willing to follow it all the way, that we might have eternal life. Well, good morning again. And God is so good to bring us together and to allow us to continue to study the third angel's message. And if you remember last week, we were talking about the third angel's message really focused on what point about our Christian life. Do you remember? I know we so oftentimes think about it in connection with the mark of the beast and the seal of God, and those things obviously are important and need to be studied. But we were looking at it from the aspect of what its final, ultimate goal for us is, and that's perfection of Christian character. And that's what we want to continue talking about today as we look into the third angel's message. Because those who are going to worship God are going to go on into perfection. And there's one book of the Bible that particularly talks a lot about this that we want to look at several verses today concerning, and I'll have the verses on the screen because there are many, but the slides are available online right now if you'd like to see them. I'm sorry they're not at smyrna.org because I couldn't load them due to not having my computer, and I think it was noted earlier why that happened, but they are in the web conference shared section. I'd like to invite you, first of all, to look in your Bibles to Hebrews chapter 5. And we're going to be looking at verses 8 through 10 here. Speaking of Jesus, it says, though he were a son, yet learned he obedience by the things which he what? Suffered. And being made what? Perfect. He became the author of eternal salvation to all them that obey him, called of God and high priest after the order of Melchizedek. I thought Jesus was already perfect, didn't you? But it says that something about Jesus had to be perfected. Paul then goes on to state in Hebrews chapter 6 and verse 1, he says, therefore, leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ, let us go on unto perfection, not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works and of faith toward God. Now, do we need to repent from dead works? Of course. Do we need faith toward God? Well, these are foundational points of our Christian experience. But Paul says that while we have to lay a proper foundation, you remember David said, if the foundations be destroyed, what shall the righteous do? In Psalms 11:3. So foundations are important. But we have to go beyond sometimes the foundations. And he says we are to go on to perfection. The word therefore, this verse begins with the word therefore. It means because of this, or for this reason, and because Christ was perfected, we are to be perfected, and we are to go on to perfection. What kind of perfection? Very same kind, friends, that Jesus had. Paul addresses the incompleteness of the Levitical priesthood in chapter 7 of Hebrews, showing that perfection could not come through it. And so in our next slide, Hebrews 7, verse 11. He says, if therefore perfection were by the Levitical priesthood, for under it the people received the law, what further need was there that another priest should rise after the order of Melchizedek and not be called after the order of Aaron? Now let me just pause. Notice that under the Levitical priesthood, and that Levitical priesthood, it included what we today call the feasts. Those things that were types of the true reality. He said no one could be made perfect under that system.
Amen.
And then he says in verse 19 these words, for the law made nothing perfect, but the bringing in of a better hope did, by which we draw nigh unto God. And Paul is using the word law here in a very broad way. He's not speaking just simply the Ten Commandments, but he's speaking about the whole system. That system that was given to them of the Torah, it could not make them perfect. Paul is emphatic that perfection was not found in either the Levitical priesthood nor in the law. But on the other hand, Paul says that a better hope has been introduced through what we draw near to God by. Perfection, he says, is not via the old school or the old system, but by rather the priesthood of Christ. And he focuses now on the main issue of the old system. And in Hebrews chapter 9 and verse 9, Paul states that that was a figure for the time then present, in which were offered both gifts and sacrifices. And now notice what he says, that could not make him that did the service perfect as pertaining to the conscience, Hebrews 9:9. Isn't it the conscience that we want to have a clear conscience, a clean conscience? You know, this flesh, friends, it's nothing. You can cut off my hand, I'm still me. Cut off my arm, I'm still me, right? You can take me and you can roll me in the dirt, I'm still me. But the thing that's important is my conscience.
Amen.
We can clean the flesh, we can fix the flesh to a degree, but it's the conscience that only God can clear. And he says that those services from the Levitical priesthood could not, now, then, future, never, make anyone perfect. They couldn't bring perfection. They couldn't bring a character to its mature stature. The conscience or the mind, friends, is the battleground of the Christian. While health reform is important, and I'm not trying to downplay it in any way, the flesh or the body of a man may be very deformed, but he may still be an upright Christian if he has a clean conscience. Now, some of you know that I like to exercise, and I exercise every day, so I'm just about it that I possibly can. But I was reading in Paul's counsel to Timothy, he says, bodily exercise profiteth little. Well, we know that it is important. It was in his sphere to keep good health. But he's saying, compared to the spiritual things, it's not the body, it's the spirit that has to be cleansed and taken care of. The Bible never tells us to have the flesh of Jesus Christ because we already have it. The Bible says that he took upon himself our fallen nature and he took flesh just as we have. But we are told in Philippians 2:5, you know the text, to let this mind be in you which was also in Christ Jesus. Jesus himself came in sinful flesh, and he conquered in that flesh, that the victory is promised to us now, to each who live by faith. In fact, in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 57, Paul says, but thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. So, if we're going to overcome sin, we're going to have victory. And should we have victory? Absolutely. And we're going to see some verses about this in a little bit. But it says that we get it as a gift from God and comes from Christ, through Christ. I've been reading my Bible through again this year. And as I was reading this morning, I was taking a walk this morning. You know, we all like to take our Sabbath afternoon walk usually. And I know I'm not going to be able to get mine in this afternoon, so I got it in this morning early. I was reading the Bible as I was walking. HMS Richards used to do that a lot, senior, you know. And I was there in 2 Timothy chapter 2, and he's saying, let all of you who profess the name of Christ depart from iniquity, depart from sin. This is what God wants us to do, friends. And in 1 John chapter 5 and verse 4, 1 John chapter 5 and verse 4, he says, "For whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world, and this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith." Friends, I can show you 100 Bible verses that speak about overcoming and victory over sin, and you cannot show me one that says that we are defeated purpose if we have Christ on our side. You cannot show me one that says it is impossible to ever live without sin. You cannot show me a single text that says it is impossible to overcome. In Hebrews chapter 9, verses 11 and 12, Paul says, "But Christ, being come a high priest of good things to come by a greater, more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is to say, not of this building, neither by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood, he entered in once into the holy place, having obtained," or the Greek says, "thus securing eternal redemption for us." Christ has made redemption possible for us, friends, and he's going to redeem us. And he's going to redeem us from something, friends. He's going to save us from something. Here in West Virginia, we're part of the Bible Belt. And we hear people say something like this quite frequently: "I got saved last Sunday. You know, I got saved." Sometimes I've asked them, "What did you get saved from?" They're not quite sure. They haven't thought about that. They just got saved. See, it means to them, "I became a Christian." But the fact is, God does want to save us. He wants to save us from ourselves. He wants to save us from sin and Satan and all evil works, friends. And he's able to do that. Amen. Now, the sacrifices of the Levitical system, they were designed to teach wonderful truths about the plan of salvation. They help us today to understand better what Jesus is doing today for us. But of themselves, friends, they had no power. It's like I used to build these little models when I was a kid, 1/32nd scale, 1/48th scale, 1/24th scale, of cars and airplanes. I must have put 8 or 10 B-17s together, Alan, when I was growing up as a kid. 4 or 5 P-51 Mustangs, those fighter planes from World War II, the bombers and Camaros and all those cars. But those were just models. There was no power in those airplanes to fly, no power in those cars to drive or run or move. But they showed me what the real was like. You know, in fact, I learned a lot from doing those things. Learned about steerage, linkage, and things, putting those little models together. But none of them had any power. And so you go back to the Levitical priesthood, and you had Pentecost, Passover, Day of Atonement, all these things, but no power. No power. The people needed something more. They got an illustration. They got an understanding of what it all meant. But they needed to understand how to get the power too. These things had no power to cleanse their minds or their conscience. But the Bible says that Christ can purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God. Now, according to Romans chapter 6 and verse 23, the Bible says that the wages of sin is what? It's death. And Romans 3:23 says that we've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. So we're all deserving of that death sentence. No question about that. And sin brings death. And dead works are works of sin. And in the life of the believer, friends, God wants to save us from those so that there are no dead works or works that bring death because of sin. Now let's continue in Hebrews chapter 10 now, where Paul reinforces his point again that the law was a shadow or a lesson book of the better priesthood that was to come. Here in Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 1, Paul says, "For the law, having a shadow of good things," to what? To come. The law wasn't the good things. Those codes, those ordinances weren't the good things, but they were shadows, an illustration of something that was good to come. See, I stand here and I cast a shadow behind me from the lights. The shadow moves with me. It looks like maybe an outline of me at least. It gives you an idea of what I'm like, but it's not me. So he says, "The law having a shadow of good things to come and not the very image of the things can never, with those sacrifices which they offered year by year, continually make the comers thereunto perfect." He says they did this year after year. But they never could make people perfect. And then in verse 2 of Hebrews 10, for then would they not have ceased to be offered. In other words, they kept offering because they didn't get the job done. It says, because that the worshipers once purged should have had no more conscience of sins. In verses 3 and 4 of Hebrews 10 now. But in those sacrifices there is a remembrance again made of sins every year. For it is not possible that the blood of bulls and of goats should take away sins. He says it just can't happen. It's not possible. And if you think about it, if you studied Leviticus chapter 16, the Day of Atonement service, when everything was supposed to be cleansed, you know what they did at the end of all that service? The high priest went back, put on his high priestly garments, and then the evening sin offering. It all started over all again. Paul, here in Hebrews 10, again states that no perfection could be found in the Levitical priesthood. But perfection is the goal all the way through. He is continually contrasting the Levitical priesthood with its feasts and sacrifices with that of Jesus Christ. One could not produce perfection, the other can. In the light of these and other plain statements that we're going to look at, friends, I believe it is a denial of the gospel to say that God's people can attain perfection of character by using these old symbols and methods and shadows. But it is also just as true that we must and can obtain perfection of character through Jesus Christ. Many people do not believe that victory over sin is possible. Yet this philosophy is actually saying, in effect, that the new covenant is no better than the old covenant. There's no more power in the new covenant than in the old covenant. We are told that perfection, total victory over sin, is not obtainable, and that our goal should be rather to simply get as close to the mark as possible. But friends, the scripture says that God's plan is to have no more consciousness of sins. God does not say some consciousness of sins. Do you get the difference? I think so. Going on in Hebrews chapter 10 now, in verse 5 and 6, Paul says, wherefore, when he cometh into the world, he saith, sacrifice and offering thou wouldest not, but a body hast thou prepared me. In burnt offerings and sacrifices for sin thou hast had no pleasure. And then verse 7 and 8, then said I, lo, I come, in the volume of the book it is written of me, to do thy will, O God. Above, when he said, sacrifice and offering and burnt offerings and offerings for sin thou wouldest not, neither had pleasure therein, which are offered by the law. And now notice verse 9. Then said he, lo, I come to do thy will, O God. He taketh away the first, that he may establish the second. What happened to the first, according to Paul here in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 9? He took it away. Why did he do that? So that he could establish the second. Friends, Paul is very plain. The first system was to be done away with, and that was the system of sacrifice and offerings. The second that would be established, he said, is the will of God. In Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 10, by the which will we are sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. Friends, what is God's will in this matter of perfection of overcoming sin? Let's let the Word explain itself. First, is it God's will? Is it God's will that we be sanctified? 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 and verse 3. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 3. He says, for this is the will of God, even your sanctification. No question about that. It's God's will. The next question is it obtainable? Matthew chapter 5 and verse 48. Notice what Jesus said. Be ye therefore perfect, even as your Father, which is in heaven, is perfect. Friends, does Jesus know what he's talking about? If Jesus tells us that we can be perfect, can we?
Yes.
Are his biddings his enablings for us? I believe that they are. In fact, in Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 8, it says, wherefore he saith, when he ascended up on high, he led captivity captive and gave gifts unto men. And then going to verse 12, he says that he gave these gifts for the perfecting of the saints. For the what? The perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. And then verse 13, till we all come in the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. As I said, I can give you 100 verses, and probably many more. I'm just using a round number. Hundreds of verses that speak in the Bible about overcoming, perfection of character, and having total victory over sin. And you cannot show me a single verse that says that we are bound to stay in sin if we are in Jesus Christ. Now, if we're outside of Christ, friends, there's no hope. Because man is totally depraved of himself. And of ourselves, friends, we could do nothing apart from Christ. In fact, Jesus said, without me, you can do nothing. He was very emphatic about it. But I want you to notice now in Hebrews 13. Hebrews 13, verses 20 and 21, what Paul here writes. He says, now the God of peace that brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do His will. Make you perfect. How often? Part of the time? Some of the time? In every good work. God's will, friends, is sanctification for the believer. And since that involves no more consciousness of sin, the ministry of Jesus must take away our sins to do this. The law cannot do this. Romans chapter 3 and verse 20. He says, therefore, by the deeds of the law, there shall no flesh be justified in His sight. Law can't do that. Not even the Ten Commandment law can't do that. No law could do that. In fact, according to Romans 4:15, the law worketh wrath. And I want you to share with you now a statement that Ellen White made that I think is so insightful. Notice carefully what she says. Were the law understood apart from Christ, it would have a crushing power upon sinful men, blotting the sinner out of existence. Let me just pause there. She doesn't say the law has to do that, but she says if the law is understood apart from Christ, away from Christ, just as it is, that strong legal arm, it has a crushing effect upon man. She says, but by understanding the law in connection with Christ, receiving Him by faith as his substitute and surety, man sees himself as a prisoner of hope. And then she continues, the truth as it is in Jesus is an acquaintance with the holy, just, and good law of God as this law is elevated and its immutability demonstrated in Christ. He magnified the law, expanded its every precept, and in His obedience left man an example that he also may meet its demands. And so you see, friends, outside of Christ, the law can only crush us. But if Christ is in us, Colossians 1:27, if He is in us, the hope of glory, then we can not only meet the law's demands, which Hebrews 10:10 declares, will bring us to the perfect will of God. And I like that idea, don't you? I'm all for that idea, aren't you? To look to Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Friends, do you think that Paul is finished at this point, contrasting the law and grace, our efforts and the work of Jesus? Not at all. He's got a lot more to say about this. And he continues to press his point. I'm going to show you what he says here in Hebrews 10, verse 11 now. Hebrews 10, verse 11. He says, and every priest standeth daily ministering and offering oftentimes the same sacrifices, which can never take away sins. Friends, if these things can't take away our sins, and if they were shadows of good things to come, and the things that they were shadows of have already come, why do we want to stay in the shadows? Amen. Why do we want to stay in the darkness? Because they can never take away sins. The old cannot take away sins, and anything that tries to bring back the old cannot either. By perfectly doing the perfect will of God, friends, we establish perfection. And going on in Hebrews 10 now, in verses 12 through 14, Hebrews 10, verses 12 through 14. But this man, after he hath offered one sacrifice for sins forever, sat down on the right hand of God. Now, let me just pause there. He says he offered one sacrifice forever. How many sacrifices?
One.
In the old system, it was sacrifice after sacrifice after sacrifice, week after week, month after month, and then year after year after year. The whole cycle kept going because that never could bring the one who came to them perfect. But he says, Jesus died one time forever, and he sat down on the right hand of God, from henceforth expecting till his enemies be made his footstool. For by one offering he hath perfected forever them that are sanctified. Now the Greek word for perfected here is from the same root word that we find in John chapter 19 and verse 30 when Jesus said, it is finished. It is finished. The product has become, in effect, complete. At each step in the plan of salvation, Jesus has perfected and finished that stage of that plan, and he will step by step bring the believer to perfection through what he calls a new and living way. In Hebrews chapter 10, now continuing verse 15 and 16 we have here, wherefore of the Holy Ghost also is a witness to us, for after that he had said before, this is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, saith the Lord. I will put my laws in their hearts and in their minds will I write them. And that's Hebrews 10, 15, 16. It's interesting here. I'll just make a little parenthetical note, and this is for someone listening who knows what I'm talking about. This is something I was speaking with someone about last night, and I missed this part, and I thought for sure it was there. But it says, wherefore also the Holy Ghost also is a witness to us. And he's quoting here, the Holy Ghost is speaking about this new covenant, and that's from Jeremiah chapter 31. But in Jeremiah chapter 31, it says it's the Lord Jehovah speaking this. So just keep that in mind. Okay, so that's just a little parenthetical. Going on to verses 17, 18. And their sins and iniquities will I remember no more. Now where remission of these is, there is no more offering for sin. You see, friends, God's new way involves receiving from him a new heart, a new mind. And God declares that he will remember our sins no more. And all this is obtained by the ministry of Jesus Christ. Now I want to ask you something. Could you ever find a better deal than that? Could you ever find a better offer than that ever anywhere in anything? No. I don't think so at all. It's by a new and living way. In Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 20, he says, by a new and living way, which he hath consecrated for us through the veil, that is to say, his flesh. By Jesus coming and living in our sinful flesh, he has consecrated the way for us. He has, if you please, paved the pathway that we may walk after him. Through the flesh of Christ, through his coming to live as we have to live and obtaining victory in the same way that we must obtain victory, we have the assurance of perfection in our lives just as much as we have Christ. In Hebrews 2 and verse 14, Hebrews 2 and verse 14, Paul says, for as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same, that through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is, the devil. Through his flesh, he has consecrated a new and living way for us. In Hebrews chapter 7, in verse 28, and by the way, you want to do something good this week? Just read the whole book of Hebrews straight through from the beginning to the end. You won't be sorry you did it. We're just coming back bits and pieces here to make this fit together, but read the whole book through. Hebrews 7, 28. For the law maketh men high priests which have infirmity, but the word of the oath, which was since the law, maketh the Son who is consecrated forevermore. If you wish to be perfect as Christ, then you need to be as consecrated as Christ. Sometimes we don't want to give up everything for Jesus, but I want to tell you, he gave up everything for us. We are told that all heaven was emptied in the gift of Christ to us. In Hebrews 7 and verse 26, for such an high priest become us, who is holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners, and made higher than the heavens. And yet, even though he's been made higher than the heavens, his humanity still reaches down to us. He who was born with sinful flesh, but not a sinner, will help all who come to him as he ministers as our great high priest in heaven today. And may I just add parenthetically again here a point. Calvinism teaches that Jesus could not come like this. This concept, this theological school of thought called Calvinistic thought or Calvinism, it teaches that sin is your nature. And therefore Jesus could not have taken a nature like we have, therefore he would have been a sinner. Where Adventism has been grounded and nurtured in the theological school of Arminianism, which means that sin is a choice It's something we choose to do in thought, word, or deed. And that the nature, the body itself is not what is sin. It's sinful. It is degraded. It leads to temptation, but of itself, it is not what condemns us. Jesus, in his humanity, reaches us. And he will help all who come to him as he ministers as our high priest in the heavenly sanctuary today. And in Psalm 77:13, you know that text. He says, "Thy way, O God, is in the sanctuary." Who is so great a God as our God? God works through the sanctuary. And in the Old Testament, in that Old Covenant, we saw shadows, we saw types that taught us about the good things to come. The good thing to come is what Jesus is doing in heaven today.
Amen.
That he's really there in a real sanctuary, in a real heaven for us today. Hebrews chapter 10, verses 21 through 23. "And having an high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering, for he is faithful that promised." Friends, this is not the time to give up our faith. It's not the time to adopt a new paradigm of thought. It's not the time to accept a new theology. And I'm going to tell you furthermore, it's not the time to start joining with those who have. It's a time to let the trumpet sound loud and clear. The Bible teaches us that we may all have hearts full of assurance because we have Jesus who is overcome in our sinful flesh. In Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 18, he says, "For you are not come unto the mount that might be touched and burnt with fire, nor unto blackness and darkness and tempest." And then in verse 19, "And the sound of a trumpet and the voice of words, which voice they that heard entreated that the word should not be spoken to them anymore." You remember when God was going to give the law? He told the people to draw near, but don't come too close to the mountain. And there was smoking and lightning and thundering, and the people were scared. They said, "Oh, you know, don't let God speak to us. He'll kill us." But going on to verse 22, Paul says, "You've not come to that. That's not your situation today." He says, "But here's where we're at today in the new covenant." He says, "But ye are come unto Mount Zion and unto the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to an innumerable company of angels." And then verse 23, "To the general assembly and church of the firstborn, which are written in heaven, and to God, the judge of all, and to the spirits of just men made perfect." And then verse 24, "And to Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant, and to the blood of sprinkling that speaketh better things than that of Abel." Remember Abel? He was offering sacrifice, but something better than that. And in verse 25, he says, "See that ye refuse not him that speaketh, for if they escape not who refused him that spake on earth, much more shall not we escape if we turn away from him that speaketh from heaven." Those people in the early covenant, in the old covenant, they heard God speak there at Mount Sinai. In fact, Ellen White, she made a statement that the Father and Son both spoke the law at Sinai. But if they didn't escape then, how shall we escape when we hear him speaking from heaven today to us? And of course, the implication is that we won't. Paul's making this implication. Now, it's been almost 2,000 years since the Apostle Paul gave up all for Christ and followed the path of Christian perfection. Why did he do this? Because the love of Christ, friends, constrained him. And the 144,000 will be constrained by the faith and love of Christ to stand in defense of the truth, even amidst apostasy and among cold companions. They will strive to vindicate the character of God before a watching universe. And this is one of the reasons, and I know you're going to like this statement, Sister Arlene, that we have been told to let us strive with all the power that God has given us to be among the 144,000. Maranatha, page 241. Do you want to do that? I do. Friend, God wants you. He wants everyone. But it will only be a few good men and women that will be ready when Jesus comes. And as Ezekiel sees it in chapter 9, there's only going to be a small final remnant. But friends, you can be a part of it. the still of God can be for you. You may have perfection of character because Christ has trodden the path for you and has consecrated it with his own blood. The will of God is clear and unmovable. You have more than a target, friends, simply to aim at. You have the very power of God through Christ, who is able to keep you from falling, Jude 24. You can be one of God's special men or women who will stand on the sea of glass and sing the song of Moses and the Lamb. You can be a part of the group of men and women who will continue in the face of the assault of the enemy and give the vital messages of the three angels. That's what I want to do. What about you? God says that there's coming a crisis in this earth. And we realize that this crisis is going to be precipitated over the issue of worship of God. Whether we're going to worship on Saturday or we're going to worship on Sunday. Whether we're going to worship on the Sabbath of the Lord or on the Sabbath of Satan, if you please. But the greatest issue of it all is who are we worshiping? And this is simply going to determine who we're really worshiping, friends. Because God's going to allow his people to stand at this time. Those who have made God their sure defense and remedy are going to have the power of God, the indwelling Spirit of Christ in their lives, and no matter what pressure is brought against them, they're going to stand it. But friends, if we don't have the true Spirit of Christ in us, if we have some kind of a phony thing, it will not be enough at that time when pressure will be brought during this time like has never been brought in the history of humanity upon people. And where are we going to stand that day? And it's only as we today, step by step, enter into this perfection of character with Christ that we'll be ready that day. And it's not far off. It's not very far off at all. And I want to be ready, don't you?
Amen.
May God bless each one of you. Lots and lots and lots to be ready. Thank you so much.